All right, good afternoon, brothers and sisters. The topic says it's all global health, climate change and environment, and there's very intimate link between the three of them. Especially when we look at global health as also talking about global environmental health, because if the planet is sick, then of course the citizens, those who live on the planet, both human and other beings, would have a very tough time surviving on it. So we look at this topic in a very interconnected way, look at ecological systems, and then the well-being of all the beings who live on the planet. Many of the activities of industry and humans generally on the planet sometimes ignore the fact that the planet, the Earth itself, is a living system, and that the Earth itself has a right to live, to survive, a right to life, has a right to perform its natural cycles without being disrupted by the activities of third parties, particularly human beings. And in fact, if you've been following the discussions on ecocide, when anyone takes any action that disrupts or stops or distorts the right of Mother Earth to perform her natural cycles, then that is a crime against the planet. And so this kind of understanding helps me to see every mining pit, every mine pit, and every oil rig, and every oil well as a crime scene. And if I had the power, I would like to put a ring around those locations that nobody, stop, don't move here, because what you are doing is actually destructive. And because they have direct impact on people who live in those territories. Over the years of my activism, I've visited most of the tours I make are not like tourists. I make pollution tours. I go to mining sites, mining communities, to see whether there's any mining community that actually enjoys the benefits of mining. And my experience around the world has been that those who live on the first line of either the mining operations or oil extraction operations or fracking operations, they are the last to benefit from those activities. And many of those communities are virtually ghost towns or towns, or if people are still living there, people who are living on the edges of graves because they are living in very toxic environment. And these activities clearly subverts anything called like the sustainable development goals that are being debated now. With those kind of activities ongoing, the communities who live anywhere close to those locations cannot attend any of those goals. Those goals go against the right to life. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights gives everybody the right to life. But when you have activities that truncate that right, then of course, that right cannot be enjoyed. Now, people who live on the first line of polluting activities don't only enjoy or are not only exposed to toxic environments, they're also generally being discriminated against, because you never find this kind of installations in well-off communities. If you match the map of extractive sector activities and polluting activities around the world, they would match closely also the kind of social standings of the persons who live in those locations, very closely. They will tell you a story about any country and any continent or any community, because nobody who has a choice would allow those kind of activities to be carried out in their backyard. Now, that is the bad news. The good news is that those who are living in such situations are not just folding their hands and taking the beating. There's a lot of organizing, grassroots mobilization going on around the world, resisting these kind of activities. Remember, some years ago, I think in 2007 or thereabout, President Correa of Ecuador declared that they think what oil is doing to the environment is really very bad, and that we have to do something about it. That's what he said. And then, of course, civil society and local people in Ecuador presented the Yasuni idea. And the man said, yes, this is the idea. We're going to leave the oil in Yasuni under the ground if international communities and nations would contribute 350, half of the amount, about 350 or thereabout dollars, 260 US dollars worth of the oil. We're going to leave it untouched. Now, I believe personally that this was a bad move because you don't leave oil in the soil. And then calculate that as kind of carbon sequestration, and then you want to be given carbon credits, because that's what the argument amounted to. I leave the oil in the ground is the best way to sequester carbon. Don't bring it out at all. So you leave the coal underground, you leave the oil underground, leave the gas, everything underground, and then you have fail-proof. Because all the carbon capture and sequestration strategies, scientists and engineers are devising, would not work as well as the one that is simply to leave that stuff where it belongs. So now, after some years, the president of Ecuador has gone against that. I said, okay, we can go to Yasuni and drill the oil. And now there are people, citizens living there who have chosen to remain uncontacted. And again, that is a biodiversity hotspot in the Amazon. And because of lack of power, the system would overrun those communities and people possibly expose the people to extinction. Now, in Nigeria, which is my country, in 1993, Yogoni people declared that all the oil in their ground, their territory, must be left untouched by Shell. And they expelled Shell from the territory. They did not say, pay us compensation for leaving the oil in the soil. They said, just leave it there. We need to have a discussion. We need to have a say in what happens in our environment. We need to have a say about who does what, and we have to have a share in the benefits. Whatever it is, any benefit, we don't want to just take these benefits and these incentives from this kind of sector. And I'm glad to tell you that by that singular move of the people, a deprived, poor, otherwise weak people, they've succeeded in keeping the oil in Ogoniland under the ground since 1993, and nobody has taken a drop from it. And there's no reason to think that very soon anybody's going to reopen the oil wells. Now, there's a lot of oil there. But the people say, now, we want a chance to leave. So this, to me, is very positive, that people could say, okay, although this thing can fetch some money for either the state or for whoever, but it's killing us, we want to leave. We need to have a healthy life. If we're not alive, we can't enjoy any other right. The African Charter of People and Human Rights, Article 24, says every African shall have a right to a safe and satisfactory environment. I believe every other charter captures this same kind of right being given, but people see the right on paper, they don't experience it. And so when you see a group of people say, no, we must enjoy our right, we have to applaud them. And many other things that contribute to global warming, apart from the burning of fossil fuels, they all, if you check them closely, they are unjust, unfair, and unsustainable. And one of these is the way we consume stuff, consumption, and displacement of responsibilities, including land grabbing. Land grabbing in Africa has become continent grab, because it's not just a few pockets of land that have been grabbed. I mean, you've done research on this and you've seen it. So now, the grabbing is not for production of stuff for the region, but for elsewhere. This makes it clearly unjust, unfair, and unacceptable. So, right, climate change and health. I'm sure we're going to hear more about this, but just think about the fact that climate change is, causing floods and droughts, and just those two items have major impacts on many regions in the world today. Many regions in the world today. In 2012, there were floods across the world, across Africa in particular. In my country, 300 people died from flooding within just 2 months, and 6 million people were displaced by flooding within 2 months. 6 million people within 2 months. That was catastrophic, if anything could be described as such. And so when you have this, you can be talking about health. And of course, can be talking about a healthy environment. So what am I saying? flooding, conflicts, rights abuses, they all go on the heels of global warming. This is why it is so urgent for us to conceive of any action being taken towards tackling this thing as a right and justice issue. United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change has the clause on common but differentiated responsibilities, which is the bedrock of justice in all that negotiation. But this has not been taken very seriously. I believe it's now the time for all of us to team up to insist and to demand that we don't just want to have rights being acknowledged on paper, we want to see rights in action. I thank you for your attention.